Hello friends, welcome to Abhinav Goswami Law Classes. So friends, in this video, we are going to discuss section 18 of Indian Evidence Act. Very important section. So friends, if you have your Bear Act with you, please open it up. Open section 18. I'm going to read from there. So friends, before going into the section, before going into the details, what you need to understand first is that we, in the previous video, we did section 17, which defined admissions. So as far as the concept of admission was concerned, what were the requirements? It was a statement. What is an admission? Admission is a statement which can be in oral form, documentary form, or it can be contained in an electronic form. Okay. But the most important thing about admissions are, and why a particular statement is called admission, is that it necessarily suggests an inference. Okay, it necessarily indicates in a particular direction or makes the person to whom that statement is made to reach a particular conclusion. So this is very important. Suggesting of inference is the most important part of the definition of admission, and inference in regard to either fact in issue or relevant fact. When these three things, statements, either oral, documentary or electronic form, and finally what? That it suggests an inference towards fact in issue or relevant fact. When these three requirements are satisfied, it is a admission. Now the question arises, and the second part of section 17 provides, and which is made by any of the persons or under the circumstances here in after mentioned. So what is it saying? It is saying that all the statements which are oral, documentary or electronic form, or which are suggesting an inference, are not admissions. Not all statements which are satisfying these requirements are admissions. Only those statements are admission which are made by specified persons or in the specified circumstances. So there are two additional conditions which are provided by the following sections. One condition is regard to the persons who can make the admission. And second category of condition is regard to the circumstances in which admission can be made. So as far as section 18, 19 and 20 is concerned, it provides for the first condition regarding the persons who can make an admission. Okay. So in that category, the first section that we are going to cover today is section 18. So it is one of the most important section, which actually tells you what are the category of people who can make admissions. Okay, so with this background, let's start with our discussion of section 18. Section 18, admission by party to proceedings or his agent. This is just a heading. Okay, now the section starts. Statements made by a party to the proceeding or by an agent to any such party whom the court regards under the circumstances of the case as expressly or impliedly authorized by him to make them are admissions. Okay. So this is the first sub part of section 18, which is the easiest to understand. So under the first part, who are the parties who are becoming eligible to make admissions? The first category of parties under subsection 1 are parties to the suit. Okay, parties to the proceeding, whether criminal proceeding, civil proceeding, the parties. Okay, appellant, defendant or petitioner, respondent. Okay, plaintiff, defendant. So these are the essential parties. Okay. So they obviously, because the dispute is between them, they are the primary people who are in fact authorized to make admissions. So parties to the proceedings, this is the easiest. So who are the people who can make admission? Parties to the proceedings. Okay, this is the first category. If you have your pen or pencil, just write one, parties to the proceeding. Now come to second. Second is about agent of such parties. Okay, so not only these parties, but their agents also are authorized by section 18 to make admissions. Now the question arises, who are the agents? Okay, agents are those people who are recognized by the court or who have either expressed or implied authority of their masters. Only such people can fall in this category of agent. So as far as agent is concerned, as far as the power of agents regarding making of admission is concerned, it is restricted by two conditions. First, that person should be accepted as an agent by the court of law. first requirement. And the second requirement that that person must have either express or implied authority of the party to the proceeding. So it is not necessary that he must have explicit document to show that this is my authority, I am an agent. Though it, if it is there, it is better. But implied authority also can suffice in some cases. Okay. So what will be the purview of implied authority? It all depends from, differs from case to case. Okay. But what we need to understand is no, it is not necessary. In every case, there has to be explicit authority. Okay. So what are the things that we learned from this first part of section 18? That there are two categories of people who are authorized to make statements under first part. First is very easy, parties to the proceeding. Second is agent of these parties. But two additional conditions, they must be accepted as agent by court of law. Second, they must have either express or implied authority of their masters or parties to the proceeding. Okay, so this was first part. Now come to second part. By suitor in representative character. Okay. Statements made by parties to suits, suing or sued in a representative character are not admissions unless they were made while the party making them held that character. Okay. So as far as first part was concerned, it was simply talking of parties to the proceeding, whatever be the case, nature of the case. But as far as the sub part is concerned, it is specifically dealing with a particular kind of cases in which those suits are filed in a representative character. Okay. So in criminal law, there is no provision for representativeness. But as far as civil law is concerned, there are certain provisions which provide for representatives of people to come to the court and seek relief. For example, if the main person, the main plaintiff is a minor, or the main defendant is a minor, then anyone on his behalf, his friend, can come and approach to the court, guardian, whatever. Okay. So all these suits which are filed in a representative character, so this person who is standing before the court as a in that representative character, he also has the power to make admissions. Okay. So this representative of that person whom he is representing has been given a power to make admissions on behalf of the person who he is representing. First thing. But it is very necessary that only those statements will fall into the category of admissions, or only those statements are admissions which are made by this person who is holding the representative character while he was holding that position. So for example, if A was appointed by B, who is a minor, for example, for representing him in a suit. Okay. So A represented B in a suit from 2015 to 2017. So whatever was said by this person A from 2015 to 17 may amount to admissions. But for example, for some reasons, this representative was removed by minor in 2017. So whatever was said will be said by this person after 2017, because he is no longer the representative. Okay, whatever he may say can never affect the case and can never amount to admissions. So as far as these representative character of suits are concerned, it is very essential that those statements must have been made while that person held that position of being representative. Right? Okay, this is the second part. Now come to third part. Statements made by party interested in subject matter. Okay. Persons who have any proprietary or pecuniary interest in the subject matter of the proceeding and who make the statement in their character of persons so interested. Okay. So as far as first and two categories are concerned, which we have already discussed, we were more or less dealing with the parties to the suit or their agents or their representatives. Right. But now, in this third part, we are going into the other persons who may not be party to the proceeding, other normal witnesses or other normal persons who may be alien to the third party to the proceedings. Okay. So, the first category of person who are not parties to the proceeding, still their statements may amount to admissions, are people who are interested in the subject matter of the proceeding. What is meant by subject matter? Subject matter means over which the dispute has arisen, because of which this proceeding has been initiated. For example, a particular piece of land. Okay. So if, for example, if there are three brothers who are fighting over a piece of land. Okay. So A has filed a case against B. Okay. So who are the parties to the proceeding? A and B. So their statement, their agent's statements, or their representative statements will be admissible under first and second part of section 18. But as far as what about C, who is not a party to the suit, the third brother. So a statement of C, because he is also interested in this property, being the brother. So the statement of C will be relevant under this third part, third 3-1 part. Okay. So because he is interested in the subject matter. Subject matter is the land, and he is interested in that. He is also a partner or partner owner of that property. So for, in that we have his statements. Whatever he says about it, whatever statements he makes about it, can amount to admissions. Okay. So what are the third category of people who are included, who can actually make admissions under Section 80? Is persons who are interested in the subject matter. Okay. And interest can be of two categories. It can be proprietary interest, or it can be pecuniary interest. What is the difference between proprietary and pecuniary? Proprietary interest essentially means that when that person is the owner of that property. Okay. Just in this case, he was a partner owner of that property. Okay. So, and what about pecuniary interest? Pecuniary interest are those cover those cases where the person may not be the owner of that property legally, but he must have invested his money in that. Okay. So for example, there was a piece of land X on which a house was constructed by a particular builder called X. So in the dispute where this entire property, land plus house, is concerned, so his statement will also become relevant, though he is not the owner of that house. He has only constructed it, but he has pecuniary interest in that. He wants his money back, whatever he has invested in that house, right? So both of these people who have proprietary or pecuniary interest, but in what subject matter of the dispute? This is very important. Now come to fourth category of people. By person from whom interest derived, person from whom the parties to the suit have derived their interest in the subject matter of the suit. Okay. Are admissions if they are made during the continuance of the interest of the person making the statement. If they are made, this is very important. If they are made during the continuance of the interest of the persons making the statement. Okay. So as far as this fourth category is concerned, it is talking about people who, though are not interested in that property right now, but who were interested in that property, and from whom this property, this subject matter which is in dispute, was actually purchased. Okay. For example, A was the previous owner of this property. A sold this property to B, C and D. Okay. In joint. So all these parties, B, C and D, are fighting with each other over this property, that I have this mess here. But A was the previous owner. So the statements of A, whatever he said, he may say about that property, because interest has been derived from him. Okay. They become admissions under this fourth category. And the same goes with father and son's relationship, when sons are fighting over property which they have derived from their father or from other ancestral people. Okay. So the same can be applied to anyone from whom the interest over the subject matter which is in dispute is arising. Okay. But it is very necessary that these statements must be made during the continuance of the interest of the person making the statement. So again, the same requirement, the statements have been to be made by such persons, the previous owners, as long as they are holding that interest of being the, you know, people who, from whom the interest has been derived. So for example, if the property has passed more than one hands, A transferred property to B, B transferred property to C, and the dispute is between C and D over this property, then A cannot come, because now B is intermittent. So B will be the person from whom the interest has been derived. Same goes with grandfather, father and son's relationship. So if these sons are C and D are deriving interest from their father directly, and father has derived his interest from his father, the grandfather. So as the dispute is between C and D, these statements of B may become relevant, not of grandfather. The statements of father may become relevant, but not of grandfather. So this is very important to understand. Okay. So persons from whom the parties to the suit have derived their interest in the subject matter of the suit. This is what you need to remember. Okay. So four category of people that are covered section 18. We will do a quick recap. So any statement, again going to the requirements of admissions, any statement, oral, documentary, electronic form which suggests an inference for fact in issue. Okay, this is admission. So who are now section 18 provides, who are the people who can make admissions? First category of people who can make admissions are parties to the proceeding, easiest. Second category, agent of those parties, but two additional requirements, that agents have to be accepted as agents by court of law, or they must have either express or implied authority. Third category, people who are suing in representative character. Okay, but in this condition, in representative character thing, it is necessary that those statements must have been made by those person while they were holding that representative character. Once they are removed from that representative character, their statements are not admissions. Now come to fourth category. Fourth category is persons who, though are not party to the proceeding, but they are interested in the property. But again, in this case also, a condition is imposed that only statement can amount to admission as long as they are still holding interest in that property. For example, if that brother C, ABC, dispute was between A and B, C was the alien to that suit, the statements of C were relevant. But for example, C sold his share to someone else, then the statements of C will no longer be relevant. Okay, so as long as he held that interest. And finally, the fifth category is the person from whom the interest has been derived. So the previous owner, your father from whom you are getting that property, or whatever be the source of the subject matter. Okay, so their statements also become relevant. Okay, but again, in this case also, the statements are relevant as long as they are continuing with the interest of being such a person. Okay, so this is what section 18 was. I hope you have understood. This is one of the most important section, which is providing for category of person whose statements are relevant. So friends, if you have any doubt, please join my Telegram group. We'll post your question into that group. I will cover that into our next live session and try to clarify your issues. Okay. So invitation link to my Telegram group is in description to the video. And please subscribe to my channel if you want to appreciate my effort. Until then, be friends, be safe, be happy. I'll come very soon and we will discuss section 19 in my next lecture. Okay, friends, be happy. Bye.